Welcome everyone to Strictly Biblical Bible Teaching Ministries. That's right, Pastor Moss at your service. Sister Moss, is she here? Oh yeah, and you'll see her later, okay? But right now, we're going to be focusing on the Word of God, on this very important Christian holiday, right? I would say, as good as Christmas is, Easter Sunday, wow. Enormous in how it focuses so much on Jesus Christ. All right, so we'll be getting into our sermon here shortly. But first, what we need is scripture reading. Let's go to scripture and see if we can get something that ties into all this. And I think we found it over in John chapter 2 and verse 19, where it says this. Jesus answered and said unto them, and these are the Jews talking to him, destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I will raise it up. Okay? That's what he said. Destroy this temple, and in 3 days, I will raise it up. Then said the Jews, 46 years was this temple in building, and wilt thou rear it up in 3 days? That's what they said. Okay? Because they thought that he was talking about the building, a temple. A temple. He wasn't talking about a temple. He spake of the temple of his body. He was telling them about the resurrection, and they couldn't grab it. Okay? So in verse 22, it says, when therefore he was risen from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this unto them. And they believed the scripture and the word which Jesus had said. Very important. Okay? Very important. Okay? Jesus fulfilling the Old Testament, because it predicted all of this as well, and Jesus' resurrection. He rose from the dead. Had he not risen from the dead, friends, then you and I would have no eternal life. We're looking at an essential doctrine of the Christian faith. And so, therefore, any of those who don't believe this, like Islam, okay, or Jehovah's Witnesses, whoever, that means, friends, that they are a cult group and they are not teaching you the truth. You must believe in certain things to make it into heaven or to be a Christian. And one of them on that list, one of the biggest ones, is that Jesus rose from the dead, died on the cross and rose from the dead in a glorified, resurrected body, and so will we, okay, if we trust in him. Very, very important stuff. All right. So, as we begin to look at this and the importance of this, okay, we do at this time want to pray for all of our sick and our shut-in. Okay. So many names, Father, we just want to bring before you, okay, Sister Pryor and others, okay, who have any sickness, any infirmity. There are so many. You know their names. You know those who need your touch. Okay. Be with them. We know, God, that you can heal with medicine or without it. We just ask you, God, to cover them with your blessing and with your anointing. And raise them up, whatever the sickness may be. Those who have economic problems, Lord, I ask that you would provide for them so that they can have what they need to be able to support the lifestyle that you've given them to survive. Just bless in Jesus' name. And we pray also here for all churches that preach the gospel in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hey, praise the Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, right now, something I can't do, I tell y'all that every time, and you're never going to tempt me to change my mind, because I can sing. I sound real good singing in the bathroom, okay? But in person, no. Let me turn you over to our praise and worship segment right now.
The day will come when you death can't keep me in the ground. Go ahead and mark my name, my love for you is still the same. Go ahead and bury me, but very soon I will be free. Cause I
that. And anytime we get a chance to praise the Lord, wow, that is a blessing. Okay, so get those Bibles out, as now we turn our attention to ministering to the Word in a message. Now the title of this message, right? Okay, I'm entitling it this: Christ versus Satan on Easter. Okay, Christ versus Satan on Easter. And what I want to show here is how the devil wants to challenge, of course, God and Christ. And he wants to challenge what Christ is doing for us because of the resurrection. Okay? So let's see what happens here as we compare scriptures and look at it. Okay? First of all, open up your Bible to Galatians chapter 3 and verse 26. Here's what God says. Here's what God's word says regarding us. In Galatians 3 and 26. So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. Amen. Okay? So in Christ, we are all children of God through faith. If you believe in him, if you trust in him. So all you've got to do is trust in God. Okay? He never said that there would not be trouble in life. There will be. If there was trouble for the apostles, if there was trouble for Jesus, then oh yeah, there's going to be some trouble and problems for us as well. But, okay, your name is already written in heaven. And you have a God you serve who answers prayer, right? So, don't listen to the devil. The devil comes against that. Okay? That idea that you're going to be children of God through faith, Satan doesn't like it. Okay? He tells you this: nobody has ever really wanted you. You are just an accident. That's what Satan wants you to think. Yeah. Nobody has ever really wanted you. You're just an accident. Friends, you are not an accident. If you are a born-again Christian, your name is already written in heaven. I don't care what it is that you have done. The blood of Jesus can wipe it away and make you whole. Don't let anybody try to put you down when Christ has already put you up so high that your name is written in heaven. All right. So that's number one, where you have God's word against Satan's counter arguments. And we, as we go down the line, we're going to see that he has a lot of things he wants you to think that are contrary to what God and Christ wants to do in your life. It says this over in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. 2 Corinthians 5, 17. Anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. I like that. Okay? That's right. Anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. And listen to this. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. Did you hear that? The old life is gone. I don't care how bad it was. Okay? It's over. Okay? The blood of Jesus Christ and his resurrection has taken that away. Okay? The old life is gone. A new life has begun. That's 2 Corinthians 5, 17. Okay? That's what the Bible says. That's what the Bible says. But of course, the devil wants to stop all of these resurrection and Easter blessings, doesn't he? Okay? So what he says is this. You will always struggle with the same old struggles. You will never be free. That's what the devil says. That's what the devil has convinced some of you into believing. But don't you believe the devil. And don't you believe people who talk to you and they're representing that kind of devilish thought. If you are a Christian, if you are saved, if you are born again, you're a new creature in Christ. And if you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive you of your sins and to cleanse you of all unrighteousness. That's right. See, talking about you will never be free. Oh no, already you are free in Christ. Also, let's go back. What does God's word say? What does God's word say? Here in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, it says this, God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us. Wow. He became sin for us. That doesn't mean that Jesus sinned in himself, but he became the substance of our sin, that we might become righteousness. We might become the righteousness of God in him. That's what we've done when we believe in Christ. We have become the righteousness of God as long as we are in him, in Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:21. But what it says over in, on the Satan side, you are just a poor, pathetic sinner. You can't do anything right. God will never forgive you. That is a lie. That's what the devil says. Okay? Yeah. On God's side again, God's word, what God's word says here in Romans 8:38-39, Romans 8:38-39, neither death nor life, listen to this, powerful, neither death nor life, neither angels, nor principalities, nor powers, neither things present, nor things to come. In other words, put your past behind you and let it go. Don't bring that mess up again. It's done. Wiped away by the blood of Jesus, right? Neither things present, nor things to come. Neither height, nor depth, nor any other creature, and any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Romans 8:38-39. Amen. Amen. The devil, what does he want you to think? Well, the devil, he wants to mess up your Easter celebration, doesn't he? By saying, look at the things you've done. Nobody's ever really loved you. Nobody will ever love you. God doesn't love you either. Do not believe the devil. Why? Because the devil is a liar. And he lied from the very, very, very beginning. All right? He wants to stop these Easter blessings from flowing, but he cannot. He cannot stop the flood of the blood of Christ that washes us clear of our sins. Next, God's word. What does God's word say? Well, in Colossians, Colossians chapter 2, okay, this is what it says, verse 9 to 10. Colossians 2, 9 to 10. For in Christ lives all the fullness of God in the human body. Okay? Right? Very powerful. That's a very powerful theological statement, right? Take this to all the cultists who don't believe that Jesus is God. Bible is real clear about it. Very, very clear. Okay? For in Christ lives all the fullness of God in human body. Okay? In human form, right? That describes the incarnation, where Jesus Christ became flesh. Over in John chapter 1, okay? Verse 14. For in Christ lives all the fullness of God. Okay? He is 100% God, 100% man. Okay? For in Christ lives all the fullness of God in a human body. So you also are complete through your union with Christ. You are complete when you're in Christ. I don't care what kind of job you have, what kind of status you have in the world. That doesn't matter. Okay? You are complete with everything you need to please God if you're a born-again Christian, if you're saved, if you're feeding on the Word of God. Don't let anybody put you down. Don't let the devil put you down. Don't let anybody bring up your past and put it in your face. That past is over. It's over. Okay? What does the devil say to these things? How does he counter all this victory that we get out of the resurrection of our Lord? Okay? What does he say? Okay? He says, you are not married. You're not educated enough. You haven't achieved enough. You are just good. You're just not good enough. Yeah. You are not married. You're not educated enough. You haven't achieved enough. You are just not good enough. That's what he wants to say. That's what he wants you to believe, that you are not good enough. That's what he wants you to stop. He wants you not to be what God has called you to be. Okay? He's caused you to not take steps that God wants you to take. He has you doubting the fact that God wants to use you in ministry, to use you to build the church, to use you to spread the gospel. All of us understand it. Every single Christian, you don't have to be an evangelist or a pastor, okay, officially. All of us are disciples of Christ. So our job, and the devil knows what our job is, that is to spread the gospel to everybody we can, everybody we can get in contact with. Yes, but in order to do that, you've got to know the Bible. You've got to get into Bible study. You need to know what the truth is, okay? And that's one way how any Bible-believing church, and also us here at Strictly Biblical, that's what we focus on. What saith the Word, okay? Okay? But you listen to the devil's voice to describe these Easter blessings that he gives us. Yeah? You are not married, okay? You're not educated enough. You haven't achieved enough. You're just not good enough, okay? But you, I'll tell you what, that's a lie. You are good enough for God. You are good enough for our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Yes, you are. Trust in him and not the lies that come from the devil. Okay? All right. Another one. One more. Okay? Here in God's word, what does God say? What does he say about us and to us? He says this in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. He says this, for we are God's masterpiece. Man, we are God's masterpiece. I don't know what you think about yourself, but if you're saved, if you're born again, you're a masterpiece to God. That's right. A masterpiece. Okay? Like a picture that needs to be hung up so that everybody can see what God has done for you. Oh, yeah. Okay. Friend, I don't know who I'm talking to now, but please let your past go. Let the things you used to do go. When somebody runs into you and they know you used to be on the street doing this or that, tell them, yeah, that used to be me, but that's not me now. I'm born again. I'm saved. I'm a new creature in Christ. And tell them, I just want to tell you how wonderful it is to be where I am because I'm in Jesus and he in me. So definitely, Ephesians 2:10, right? For we are God's masterpiece. Yes, you are. You don't have to be like anybody else. And the only person you've got to please is God. And I'm here to tell you, if you please God, God's going to use you to bless other, other folks. Okay? Bring them into the kingdom. Yes, that is our job. That is our focus. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus. That's right. You're new. So forget that old stuff. Forget that old past. Forget those things you used to do. Okay? Forget where you used to have been. Make sure that now you just stay with the Lord. You stay in church. You stay in the Bible. You do what God commands you to do. And he will bless you. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. For we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus. So we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. That's right. Jesus has a plan for you. Before you were born, he knew what he wanted you to be. What he wanted you to become. He wants all of us to be saved. But we have to choose him. In other words, God wants you to love him. And there can be no love unless there's choice. What makes a marriage so good is that a husband knows that the woman that is with him is not because he bribed her or anything like that, but that she chose to be with him. Yeah? So that's the same for the man or the woman. You want to be with someone who chooses you. Yeah? You have free choice. God gives mankind a free choice. Nobody goes to hell by accident. They go there because they deny what Jesus Christ offered on the cross. That's right. You have to pass by and pass up the love of God to wind up into hell. Okay? All you've got to do to get into heaven, listen, if the thief in the cross could get in, okay, the thief who hung on the cross with Jesus, if he got in, then you know we serve a loving and a forgiving God. That's right. That's right. If you're with family members right now, find one of them in your family who's not saved and ask them, why not? Okay? And they might say, well, I can't be that good. Let them know. It's not your goodness that saves you. It's Jesus Christ who makes you a new creature in Christ and causes you to become born again. Turn your life over to him. Become saved. And get your name written in heaven so that you can enjoy the Easter blessings, let us call them, which come to us through the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The devil wants you to think you have no purpose. That's a lie. That God has forgotten about you. That's a lie. Your life is hopeless. That's a lie. God wants all of his redeemed children to dwell with him. And here on this earth, he wants us to serve him. Easter, what a wonderful day where we see Jesus after all of the crucifixion that he went through, the horror of it, okay? The horror of the crucifixion, rising from the dead. In a glorified body, showing us that we friends are going to do the same thing. One day a trumpet's going to blow. We will rise from the dead in glorified, resurrected body, just like Jesus is. That's what's coming. That is the glory of Easter. Until then, we no doubt need to pay close attention to what we see in Ephesians chapter 6, right? In verse 11, where it says, put on the whole armor of God so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Mm-hmm. And in Ephesians 6 and 13, therefore take up the whole armor of God so that you may be able to withstand on the evil day. And having done everything to stand, everything to stand, stand firm. And then in Ephesians 6 and 14, final verse, stand therefore and fasten the belt of truth around your waist and put on the breastplate of righteousness. Friends, Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. And we are looking forward and waiting for our resurrection as well, in a glorified body. Now, there's another resurrection, and that is the resurrection to damnation, where just as we are going to be raised in glorified, immortal bodies like Jesus, the wicked will be raised in what is called damnation bodies. Our bodies will suit us to live and dwell in heaven. The unbeliever's body will suit them, along with Satan, to be in hell. Friends, we thank God for his blessings. We thank God for his salvation. And all you've got to do to become born again and saved is to trust in Christ. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you, most of all, for your resurrection. Because we know, even though we're healed and we get healed in this life, nothing can compare with the glorified body we will have when we're raised from the dead and live with you. Just bless and be with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, praise the Lord, everyone. Hopefully you enjoy Easter celebration. And always remember, the reason for the season is Jesus and his resurrection. Sister Moss?
God bless everyone on this Resurrection Sunday. Let me say, happy Resurrection Sunday.
Yes,
he rose. Good message today, Christ versus Satan. And we already know who won, no doubt about it. We already know who won and who will always win.
Yes.
He won in the past, he's winning today, and he'll win forevermore.
Right.
So thank God, he rose from the dead. Jesus did. And because of him rising from the dead, we're able to stand here today. So thank you so much for tuning in and gracing us with your presence on this Resurrection Sunday. And I pray that you keep in mind it's all about him rising from the dead.
Amen.
It's not about the Easter bun. It's not about the Easter basket. It's not about the ham and whatever. It's not about that.
Right.
It's about, we can celebrate and eat some ham, okay?
Eat it.
But just keep in mind, while you eat that ham, that Jesus rose from the dead.
Amen.
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 So God bless you once again. I want to take this opportunity to invite you to come out and be a part of our in-person service. And that address, once again, is 205 North Main Street, 205 North Main Street, right there in Clawson, Michigan. We would love to have you to come and grace us with your presence in person.
Amen.
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 Amen. And we just want you to continue, not going to say a whole lot today, just want you to continue to enjoy yourselves on this day.
Amen.
And keep in mind that Jesus rose from the dead.
Amen.
And Pastor, you know, just before we close, we want to admonish you not to click your TVs or your iPads, however you watch this in-person service. Don't click it off right away. Because at the very end, we have an interview. A couple of people are being interviewed regarding the significance of the resurrection.
Yes. Uh-huh.
So don't turn that down. Don't click off on your iPad. But stay tuned at the very end. And Pastor, on that note, we're going to get ready to close. And we want to say today, know that he has risen from the dead. Amen. God bless you and happy resurrection. And we'll see you next time.
God bless.
We want to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And that time is quickly approaching. But I'm going to interview a couple of people today that can tell you a little bit about the resurrection. And we have Sister Barbara Smith, and she's going to share with us why the resurrection is so significant, Barbara.
The resurrection is very significant because it helps us to recognize the sacrifice that Jesus made for us when he didn't even have to.
Okay.
He saved a wretch like you, a wretch like me, and a wretch like you are. He is wonderful. It's an introduction to him for people who don't know him. Mm-hmm. Learn as much as you can about him, mm-hmm. because it's worth it. I love it.
Amen.
Amen.
So are you saying that had he not risen from the dead, that we wouldn't be here today as Christians?
We would be hell bound, eternally hell bound.
Okay.
Thank you, Jesus, for having mercy on us, giving us that grace. Thank you.
Yes. So there's
great significance when it comes to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We have someone else we're going to have to come on here. We have a brother, Brother Leon. He's going to tell us something about the resurrection. Let me ask you this question, Brother Leon. There are some people who believe that the resurrection is either a myth or a legend. What say ye? What say ye?
Oh, no, actually, definitely it's not a myth or a legend. We know that the resurrection is the essential doctrine of the Christian faith, and one cannot be a Christian unless he or she believes in the resurrection.
What about that word essential? Break that down for us. Essential, what does that word mean?
It's necessary. You must believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ in order to be a Christian. There would be no Christianity without the resurrection. You know, Jesus said that, you know, if you destroy this temple in 3 days, I will raise it up. But he was talking about his body. And that's the one thing that Christians, that we all are looking forward to, is a glorified, resurrected, immortal body that we may live eternally with you, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Well, praise God. So you're saying that there's great significance when it comes to the resurrection
Absolutely.
Of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Absolutely. That's part of the gospel which we preach, which is found there in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 and 4, where Jesus said, you know, he died, he was buried, and he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. So it is essential that we believe in the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Well, you heard it from Brother Leon. Thank you so much. And we're going to get a summation from our pastor. He just disappeared here. Pastor, where are you? Well, that's okay. Then perhaps I will sum it up. Now, you've heard from both these, the brother and the sister, concerning the significance of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and there is great, let me use the word, divine significance when it comes to the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So no, for those of you who may not quite understand it or say, well, I don't know if I really believe, no, it's not a myth. It's not a legend, and as our brother said, it is essential. We must believe in the resurrection of our Lord and Savior. He came, he died, and he rose again. And on that note, I want to say, he has risen. God bless you.